Rick, I appreciate you sharing. Sometimes I feel like wearing a sign, or at least something internal, to remember the immigrant population around me. And the sign that I would wear would say, third generation. Third generation, that's what I am. Third generation immigrant. My grandmother came here from Sweden. I had to learn the language. I had to figure out how to survive here in the United States. And so I think many of us can think of ourselves that same way. And so the thought of wanting to be the kind of people that welcomed my grandmother here motivates me. So, but let's pray. We're going to be in the book of Acts this morning. So if you have your Bibles, find Acts chapter 3, and I'll pray and we'll get started. There we go. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word, and we ask that as we spend time in this chapter this morning, you would speak to us. Lord, I pray that you would remove all of the distractions that would keep us from hearing your voice, and that we would hear your voice clearly and loudly. And not only that, but we would respond to it the way you want us to. And I ask this for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to be looking at a passage of scripture this morning in Acts chapter 3, which contains a song. And I'm glad that Angie didn't sing this song this morning, simply because I don't like motion songs. In fact, years ago, I learned how to play the guitar specifically so I didn't have to do motion songs, just because I find them kind of irritating. But there's a motion song in here, and you'll see it when we get to it. But the chapter begins with Peter and John going up to the temple to pray. Well, it says at the hour of prayer. We're not exactly sure why it is they were going up to the temple. It may have been to pray, but the temple was also a place where people met and where rabbis taught. So it may be that they were going up there to teach. It doesn't make any difference really why they were going there. It was on their planner, though. It was on their calendar. And they had a specific place that they were going, and they had a specific thing to do to help the gospel spread. And so they're on their way. They're on their way, if you will, in our language, we would say, they were on their way to church. Now, Peter and John are church leaders. They had just been through this incredible experience of Peter preaching a sermon and thousands of people instantly becoming church members. They have an instant megachurch. You think these guys had some things going on? And now they're heading up. The next thing on their list of things to do is to go up to the temple, either to pray or to have a meeting where they're going to teach people. They have their day planned. And on their way there, they're interrupted. A lame man was being carried, who was daily laid at the gate of the temple that's called the Beautiful Gate, to ask for alms entering the temple, or from people entering the temple. This is a common thing. I don't notice it so much here in Coon Rapids, but I noticed it all the time in Strasbourg, where people were constantly walking. There would be beggars sitting on the pavement with a sign or asking for money. Oftentimes they sit outside of churches thinking that maybe they'll get something. And so that's what was going on here. There's a beggar sitting there. Again, not an uncommon thing. But this time, when Peter and John walk through the temple gate, the beggar asks for money, and Peter stops and says to the beggar, "Look at us." And in verse 5 it says, he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. But Peter said, "I have no silver and gold, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and raised him up. And immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. And leaping up, he stood up and began to walk and entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. And there's the song. He went walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God and recognized him as the one who sat at the beautiful gate of the temple asking for alms. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. And while he clung to Peter and John, all the people, utterly astonished, ran together to them in the portico called Solomon's. It's a wonderful story. We like to tell it to the kids and have the kids jump up and down and leap and praise God. It's a wonderful story. And I'm sure part of the story for us, part of the lessons for us, has to do with being ready for the interruptions of the day. I knew somebody one time, this was years ago, back when cell phones weren't so common. She had what was at the time called a day timer. Anybody remember day timers? Anybody here remember day timers? Well, she happened to have her day timer opened. And she had, for the entire week, every minute of every day scheduled. There was not a break anywhere. And I asked her, "What if something unexpected happens?" And she got a horrified look on her face because she had no margin for anything out of the ordinary happening. If something out of the ordinary happened, she'd have to tear out the pages in her day timer. And some of us live like that. And again, Peter and John had an incredible schedule, I'm sure. And yet, they were not too busy to listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit. And when this one particular beggar asked for alms, the Holy Spirit said, "Stop! I want you to tell this person he's healed." And the power of God moved, and this person was instantly healed. Because Peter and John were sensitive to the Holy Spirit. And obeying the Holy Spirit, obeying what God wanted them to do, was not more important than their carefully planned schedule. It's an important lesson, but it's not the major lesson of this chapter. The people are gathered around him. They want to know, how did this happen? They're astonished. They're amazed. And they're in Solomon's portico. This is a place in the temple where the rabbis used to teach. And so it was not unusual to have somebody addressing a group of people there. And this huge crowd is gathered around. The man probably has stopped leaping and jumping and praising God at the moment. But he's clinging to Peter and John, amazed at what's happened to him. And the people are gathered saying, what's going on here? And Peter addresses the people, and he says this in verse 12. "Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we have made this person walk?" Why do you stare at us thinking that we have some type of supernatural power? Like we've tapped into something and we can now go, be healed to anyone we want to. Why do you look at us like that? That's not what's going on here. Or why do you look at us as if somehow we have become so godly that our godliness heals people? Why do you look at us like that? Because that's not what's happening. No, it's not by power, not by piety. Instead, Peter focuses the attention not on himself, but on Jesus. Jesus is the one who healed the lame man. This is what he says. The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate when he had decided to release him. You denied the holy and righteous one and asked for a murderer to be granted to you. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And his name, by faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given the man this perfect health in the presence of you all. He says it's not by our own power, it's not by our own godliness that this person has been healed. Instead, it is by the faith that is, and it's a weird phrase, the faith that is through Jesus. The Greek there has a strange nuance to it that indicates that not only is the faith in Jesus, the faith came through Jesus. There's this relational aspect to faith that's going on here, as if faith was granted to them by Jesus. The idea here in this passage is we're believers in Jesus, and as we're walking in faith in Jesus, Jesus has moved in that relationship and caused us to do what we have done. And through that faith, this person has been made well. It's not us, it's Jesus working through us that has made this person well. But that's not all they said there. They said that this Jesus is the one you killed. This Jesus, whom we are now testifying is alive, is the one you killed. You denied him. And now this man is walking because of him. Whoa. There's an edge to what Peter is saying here. He's not just saying, believe in Jesus and this can happen, although that's part of it. He's pointing out that this Jesus is the very one whom they had denied, whom they had condemned. You killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. Strong stuff. Verse 17. And now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your rulers. Jesus on the cross said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Peter says, I know you acted in ignorance. You didn't know what you were doing. Your leaders didn't know what they were doing. Part of this is from God, because God foretold by the mouth of the prophets that the Messiah, the Christ, would suffer. And thus, he fulfilled the prophecy. But you acted in ignorance. Scripture is clear, though, that ignorance comes from something. Ignorance is not just a lack of knowledge. It's a lack of knowledge that springs from something else. In the book of Ephesians, chapter 4, it says something very important. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17. Now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding and alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardness of their hearts. In other words, Paul is teaching us that the ignorance springs from a hardness of heart. You harden your heart to what God is doing, what God has said, and the result is ignorance. In the story of the birth of Jesus, there's a couple of amazing people. Simeon and Anna. They're in the temple. They're worshiping God. Their hearts are open to Him. They see the baby Jesus. He hasn't done anything yet except cried and messed his diapers. They see the baby Jesus. And they recognize Him to be the Messiah. Their hearts are soft and pliable before God, and their eyes can see. But the leaders and the large mass of people with whom Jesus interacted could not see Him because of the ignorance that was in them due to the hardening of their hearts. This is what happens when our hearts become hard. It clouds our understanding. Our hearts become calloused. We lack understanding of what God is doing. And our souls begin to wither. We look for substitutes to try to ease the ache that we feel inside. Some of these things may be good things, quote unquote. We may try to busy ourselves with activity, or we may turn to some type of chemical stimulation, or we may lose ourselves in endless internet surfing, trying to find that little jolt of, ooh, look at that, because our souls are withering, because we're separated from God. We're separated from what we were created to live in. Verse 17, I know, brothers, that you acted in ignorance, as did your rulers, but what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets, that His Christ would suffer and thus be fulfilled. He then makes an offer that we need to hear, that we need to understand. That offer is this: you can have freedom from guilt. You can have freedom from the shame that comes from rebelling against God. That ignorance springs from a rebellion against God, for which you are responsible. That can be wiped away. Your sin can be completely forgiven. The guilt and the shame disappear. The way he puts it in verse 19 is this: your sins may be blotted out. When you think of blotting something out, what do you think of? I think of taking a paper towel and dabbing at something. Is that what you think? Is that the image comes to your mind? That's one of several different possible meanings. A better word for it would be obliterated, destroyed, gone, vanished. Your sins might be completely wiped away. Gone. This is huge. Not only that, times of refreshing can come from the Lord. Some of us are here and our souls inside, we're withered, we're parched, we're in a desert. And Peter is saying, you can have refreshment. You can have an oasis. Jesus said, I have come that they might have life and have it to the full. He talked about the Holy Spirit flowing from within like streams of living water. The psalmist talked about drinking deeply from the river of God's delights. We can have that. Peter's saying, you can have this. You can have refreshment for your soul. Verse 20, it also says that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus, that you might know in a real way Jesus Christ. See, Jesus isn't dead. He is alive. And you can know him. You can know him. He came to earth and died on a cross so that you today can know him and have a relationship with him. That's who he is. And he wants to give that to you. In verse 26, it says, God raised up his servant to bless you. To bless you. Jesus wants to bless you. He wants you to know blessings like you have never, ever experienced. One of the things that we need to realize is we were created to walk in a deep, deep partnership, for lack of a better term, with Jesus. And all of the blessings that are his are ours. They're ours. We can have them. Now, I don't know what you think of when you think of that. We live in a materialistic age, and we will tend to think of those blessings as material blessings. But which is better? To have lots of stuff? Or to have a completely satisfying life that is a blessing and a source of joy to others, regardless of how much stuff you have? Where it doesn't make any difference how much stuff you have. Stock market crashed this week, down what, 14% or whatever it was? Some of you were like, who cares? I don't have anything in the stock market anyway. Others of you are going, whoop, there went my vacation. But what if your satisfaction in life had nothing to do with how the economy was going? Wouldn't that be a greater blessing? Wouldn't it be great if your life impacted dozens, if not hundreds of people in a positive way, if your life itself was a blessing to others? Peter says, you can have all of this. You can have freedom from guilt and shame. You can have refreshment from your soul, for your soul. You can have a deep relationship with Jesus that causes you to live a blessed life. You can have all of it. He's offering this to people who he just said, you killed the author of life. That's who he's offering it to. He says, you need to do two things. You need to repent and you need to turn back. You need to repent. What does that mean? Halt, about face, double time. That's what it means. Stop, turn around, go the other way. You were ignorant because of the hardness of your heart in rebellion against what God was doing. You need to turn around, go the other way. That's what it means. You killed the author of life? Go the opposite direction now. Turn to the author of life. Turn to him. The other phrase he uses is the word turn back. Turn back. Or we might use the word return. Return. Story of the prodigal son. Took half the inheritance and squandered it. In riotous living, the King James Version says. He squandered it in riotous living, wound up eating pig slop. It's all gone. He's living with the pigs. And then he decides to go home. That's what the phrase turning back means. Coming back to Jesus. Coming back to Jesus. If we repent, if we return, then we can have freedom from the guilt and shame of sin. We can have refreshment for your souls. We can have a soul-satisfying relationship with Jesus and live a life of blessing. And that's what God is inviting us to today, to repent and turn back. In the prayer time before the service today, we were praying and I had this picture in my head of people who had slivers in their soul. Slivers in their soul. And they were living with that sliver in their soul. And that sliver was becoming infected. And I just sensed that there are some of us here this morning who are living with sin in our lives. They're living with sin in their lives that's causing us to become spiritually sick. We're wondering where the presence of God is. Yet, at the same time, we're living our life in the same pattern that we always do, but inside we're withering because there's a sliver in our souls. And God's calling us to return, to come back, to repent so that our sliver can be taken out, so that our soul can be healed, so that we can be satisfied in our souls. This is what God is calling us to this morning. This is what God wants for us. It's an invitation. Regardless of what you've done, regardless of what you've done, Jesus says, come home. Come home. I want you to be refreshed. I want you to be healed. I want you to know my grace and my forgiveness. I want to do life with you. Don't do it on your own anymore. Repent. Turn back. The times of refreshing may come from the Lord. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for your word, Lord. And Lord, I pray that we would be sensitive to what your Spirit is saying to us. That we would recognize that our hardness of heart needs to be exposed by you. So we ask that your Holy Spirit would expose the hardness of our hearts. That your Holy Spirit would point out sin in our lives. And that we wouldn't excuse our sin. But that we would come to you. Say, Lord, I'm guilty. And I come to you for forgiveness. I'm coming back to you, Lord. Take me in your arms. Let me know your love. Lord, refresh my soul. I want to walk with you. I'm tired of walking in a barren land with a barren soul. So I come to you. Lord, I lay down my sin. I lay down my pride. I lay down my judgmentalism. I lay down my lust. I lay down my greed. I lay down my anger. And I come back to you. And I ask that you would wash me, cleanse me. That your Holy Spirit would flow within me, that I would know your blessing, in Jesus' name, amen.
Stand and sing.
Let them flow in sea.
ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Take my voice and let me sing. Lips and let them be filled with messages from thee. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as you choose.
Father, send us from this place refreshed in our souls. Lord, send us from this place forgiven. Send us from this place walking hand in hand with you. Lord, send us from this place to be a blessing to others. Lord, we look at our week and we see things we need to do. Lord, open our eyes to those moments when a beggar is asking for alms and you want to move by the power of your Spirit. Lord, open our eyes. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you for coming this morning. Rick's got a table out back. He's got lots of information about what God is doing here in the Twin Cities, particularly through Envision. Stop by and say hello. In the meantime, we have donuts and cookies and coffee. Enjoy one another's fellowship. Zap.